What's up with everybody showing up with angular cheilitis lately?
Find out on today's Medical History Mysteries.
Everybody, we are back for Medical History Mysteries. Tom, where you been?
Where did we go? I feel like I was transparent and suddenly, like Scotty beamed me back. I don't know what happened, but here I am and I'm with you and life is good again, Pam. So all
life is good. I know schedules have been crazy, but don't worry, everybody out there. We have missed you and it is we are back. So here we are. So, okay, we're going to be talking about angular cheilitis. Here we are. Fall's coming, changes of weather. And I'm seeing people show up with all these little cracks in their mouth. They open their mouth and all of a sudden you're starting to see little shards of blood coming out. Talk to me.
First of all, it's probably one of the most painful, non, you know, life-threatening conditions you can have. You know, it's almost a nuisance, and yet it affects almost every part of your life as far as quality of life, because you can't speak, you can't eat, you know, you can't even yawn good when you have angular cheilitis because of the intense pain and the fact that you've got blood in the corners of your mouth. So why is it, as you said, everybody all of a sudden has angular cheilitis? I can tell you it's probably lifestyle, first and foremost, okay? Nutritional deficiencies, especially. You and I both know a lot of people are on weight loss medications. They're not eating as much and they're eating right. You know, I'm not going to throw any stones at any GLP-1 agonist, but if you're not eating or you're eating a limited amount of food, you know, if you're not making the right nutritional choices, that can happen. So if you have nutritional deficiencies in the B vitamins, iron, well, you know, that's protein, that's certain veggies, you know, you lose those things, you know, that can easily lead to angular cheilitis. So can a lack of zinc. A lot of people don't take zinc as a supplement because it upsets their stomach, rightfully so. So we start with nutritional deficiencies, but then I'm often worried about the potential for opportunistic infection, right? A lot of people are on immunosuppressant drugs. A lot of people are on medications for rheumatoid arthritis and all the like. And some people are on medications that aren't considered medications, but are, like cannabis, right? Cannabis is immunosuppressive. And again, we're talking about using substances that increase your risk of infection. Well, in the mouth, it's always about infection. It's always about having opportunistic organisms ready and willing to go. So the problem with angular cheilitis, in my perspective, is diagnosing the cause. Is it bacterial? Could be staph, could be strep. Is it fungal? You know, again, if I'm a layperson, I don't know these things. So how would I even begin to diagnose it? And how would I therefore begin to even treat it?
We also know from a dental perspective, you may not know this, but this is definitely something that's pretty common in the PROS world, is that if your patient presents with a reduced vertical dimension of occlusion, meaning when they bite together, this space here is reduced, whether it's worn dentition, lost teeth, right, worn dentures, and then they'll get a accumulation of saliva with their reduced vertical dimension, and they can get angular cheilitis that way. So for something that is so multifactorial, what do we do as clinicians to hopefully get it right, but also we're not going to throw them, you know, everything under the sun, right, in one shot? So do you have an idea on, you know, maybe we ask questions first and try to identify what it is? And then do we start with, hey, let's start with a multivitamin or take your B supplements? Or are there times when we're like, eh, I think it might be fungal, we should put something topical on? What should we do?
So good question, Pam, because, you know, first thing I'd like to discover on my end, if I'm looking at this patient, is do they have that reduced dimension? Because if they have those pockets of saliva, that's just a breeding ground for bacteria and fungi. So I first thing I need to do is maybe address that, okay? But, you know, beyond that, now, if I believe it's nutritional deficiencies or behavior, lifestyle, those are the questions I need to ask. So the patient's going to present with this angular cheilitis, and one of the first things I'm going to ask him is, okay, so have you changed your diet lately? You know, have you changed the food you eat? Sometimes, to your point, we can even add another point to it. If I have, you know, if I have periodontal disease or I have pain, you know, oral pain, I'm going to change my diet. I'm not going to eat protein. I'm not going to eat foods that are difficult to chew and difficult to swallow. I'm going to switch over to simple carbs and fats, things that kind of just slide down my throat and minimal chewing. Okay, but I'm now changing the nutritional makeup of the food I'm consuming. And so that can lead to these deficiencies. Plus, if I'm on a drug like a GLP-1 agonist and I'm not eating very much, I can think I'm changing my diet, but really what I'm doing is just eating less. And so, okay, if I normally would have, a meal that contained proteins and starches and vegetables, well, if I eat the protein and I get full and I'm done, well, then I don't eat the starches and the vegetables. And I don't think I've changed my diet. To me, I just ate less, but I've changed the consistency of my diet. And then I'll ask him, if it's not that, is it a medication? Because we all know that xerostomia can result in angulocheilitis too. So have you changed medications? Have you taken a dietary supplement that causes xerostomia? And if I'm striking out on all those things, I'm just going to ask them, when did it start? Because I think they have a vested interest since they know having angulocheilitis affects almost everything, as I said, all of the basic things you do in life, eating, chewing, speaking. So if it affects you every minute of every day, I'm sure you have a vested interest as a patient in wanting to get it cleared up. So just tell me the info and then we can work out a solution together.
If it's fungal, what do you suggest?
That's a tough one. I love nystatin only because nystatin is not absorbed as a drug in your bloodstream. So there's no risk of drug interactions or overdose. Nystatin oral suspension is something I might look at as a possibility. The problem with nystatin oral suspension is it's a liquid, so it doesn't really stick around very long. If you look at the nystatin external creams, well, they're for external use. Now, I've heard clinicians say, well, yeah, but I use it anyway. I don't know how good they taste, to be honest. And I'm not a big fan of using for external use only products in the mouth. So I might attempt to go with the Mycelex Strokey, perhaps. But again, I'm not 100% sure that's going to work on angulocheilitis. What I've seen most clinicians do is, again, use a topical antifungal. But you and I think, would agree that's something that's going to be the individual clinician's decision based on whether or not they feel comfortable prescribing an external use only product for the corners of the mouth. I guess you could say that might be justified. But also, maybe the patient's not going to be willing to do that because of the taste. And the one thing I can tell you for sure, Pam, is that the one thing you and I and everybody else might overlook is changing the weather. The winter comes, things get dry, right? And you're staying indoors, that air is dry because it's heated. So sometimes angulocheilitis is none of the above, it's just environmental. And so again, those are the kinds of questions we'd have to pursue.
So investigate, diagnose, and then treat. Don't just do a shot in the dark and hope for the best.
Agreed. And realize you're making a tremendous difference in that patient's life. And they'll love you forever. If you can get to the bottom of it and get them out of pain where they can resume a normal life, they're going to love you forever.
Well, this was great. Thanks for increasing awareness about angulocheilitis. I think it's one of those things that sometimes we see and overlook, or we see and maybe we don't investigate as much as we should. Or, sometimes it has to be bad enough for the patient to want to do something about it.
That
And
I agree with.
there are
Absolutely.
things we can do about it
Yeah.
way earlier before it gets really bad. So
Exactly.
this was a good one to come back to.
I agree. And listen, I just want to say thank you to all the people out there who've been attending my live seminars and lectures who have said to me, "What's going on? Are you gone? Or what happened to Pam?" And I keep saying, we're coming back. We're coming back." So we're back. It's a beautiful feeling.
We're back. All right.
Back,
So,
baby. Back.
everybody, we will see you all next week for Medical History Mysteries.
Thanks, everybody.
Bye.